was very much more about the clinical effectiveness, and obviously as a CCG we have had to look at the financial impact it may have on us as a CCG. We're unclear at the moment because we're, as to how many of the individual funding requests will come through. This as a whole is part of another piece of work that we've done reviewing the PLCP policy and also the web-based system as well. So altogether we think there may be about £2 million, but I think that's a very, it's not clear, it's very difficult to pull out these exact procedures to say, no, that's definitely something.
Obviously with as there is a local authority too, with a limited resource, we have a duty to make sure that we use that as effectively for the population as possible, whilst at the same time very carefully watching quality of care and that individuals are not in disadvantage through it. So there have been estimates, but as Nessa said, we're going to have to follow that up and see the effect of it. And from a, as you suggested, Tony, an impact on the patient as with the impact on best use of resource.
Thank you. I've got Tom, and then Warren, and then Walter.
Thanks very much. My question just on services for religious reasons. I see that it's still going to be funded on the NHS if clinical exceptionality applies. I was just wondering if you could give me an idea of how that would translate, since it's not really a clinical operation, and if there are substantial costs, or is it a very sort of real...
Well, actually, sometimes there are clinical reasons for a circumcision, without going into too much gory detail. There are circumstances under which either a child or adult may require a circumcision.
But that would, of course, be for clinical reasons.
Yes, exactly, for cultural reasons.
And so, is this rather, you know, the operation or the process shifting from, you know, one that takes into account religious reasons to just medical or clinical consideration?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair. Just in reference to 2.3, it comes to EIA's quality impact assessments.
And
we're really interested to see where any local groups consulted with, such as the LGBT network.
Yeah.
As obviously there is certain clinical areas here which affect mainly those within the LGBT community.
Yes.
I'd just be interested to see, in terms of the consultation, were there any groups consulted with? Because it does make sense to just clinicians.
Trans
Students
Trust.
Okay.
We were briefed about that, and
it's on the website, isn't it? It's on our governing body papers if you want to send the link.
That'd be really helpful, actually, if that's
okay.
Thank you, Jen.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I wanted to ask you about clinical exceptionality. How does that operate? I mean, does your GP make a recommendation? Does that mean clinical exceptionality?
It could be either, it's an appropriate clinician, it could be either a GP or it may be that your GP is referred for advice from a specialist, and the specialist detects that's an appropriate thing. And we have a process that the clinical information is then passed to a group that go through the process on our.
You'd have a panel, so if you disagree with the GP, it would go to the group that we decide.
It has to come from a clinician. It could, because it's about clinical details, but that could be a GP or a specialist.
David, you've been well questioned, haven't you? Sorry. Very quickly. And it's picking up on what Councillor Usher thought about. I appreciate your fellow assistants, there's a requirement for surgical circumcision, and I'd be the last person to suggest that protocol should be used for religious purposes, but do we not potentially leave our
one of the things on my top actually that was discussed in governing body to make sure that that it was made aware of how this could be done in a safe way.
That was one of the
things
that was made in
at
governing body.
Right. Because it was like this.
It is normally through the website that we use and the patient groups that we have, you know, the practice groups that we'd be sharing that, and obviously with yourselves, so using the networks that we've already got.
As I say, what we have to bear in mind is this is was a routine review of a policy that is there anyway, that has been there for years before the CCG was there. We felt this time we wanted to consult far more widely about it than had been in previous reviews to enhance the sort of public input to our decision making.
Just about the individual funding request, how does that happen? Who would instigate that? Would it be? Is it the same question?
Yeah.
Sorry. I thought it was.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
First point I wanted to cover was progress with recommendation one, which is around developing one system with shared governance arrangements. And just bring the committee's attention to two distinct pieces of work that have gone on from both the provider and commissioner perspective, but actually they're both aiming to achieve the same outcome, which is moving to an accountable care system by 2020. So we've been working with the Advancing Quality Alliance, which is ACQUA, which is the acronym you've seen in the paper. The purpose of that is to work with the whole system to test out what a new model might look like from a provider perspective. That work is engaged right across the whole system from both providers and commissioners. It's been predominantly provider-led, but it's focused on using older people's services as a means of testing out what a new model might look like. It's developed around what I call the eight localities, which feed into the four hubs, and the four hubs actually mirror the parliamentary constituency. So we're trying to ensure that there's that congruence between what health and social care are delivered. The approach will be tested through two locality areas in the Birkenhead constituency. It's been really positive in that it has engaged the whole system, and there are some tangible outcomes in terms of how the system might look in the future and how that will be developed. The other elements around recommendation one was from a commission perspective. So a lot of work has gone on with CCG and part of Public Social Services around looking at an integrated commissioning hub and how the services might commission services together in the future. The work has moved on, and there is a regular board that meets every 2 weeks now, and intentionally meets on a very regular basis.
is from one from a public provider perspective, the other from a commission perspective. They're actually both aimed at moving forward in a much more integrated system where we're looking to reduce some of the duplication that could potentially take place within both commission and provision, and work to provide services that are really, really focused on what the public require.
Try and just give you a snapshot and flavour of the work we've been trying to do in sections 3 and 7, because there were some cross-cutting themes there that you asked us to focus on, which were around capacity, quality, having a person-centred approach, changing cultures and best practice. So we do live quite neatly together. In terms of our community developments, we've been working as a whole system, provided by commissions working together, and we've been working with the East Information Care Improvement Team, looking at what new models of care might need to look like going forward and working with what's the local and national best practice. So you'll be aware that we've had, as a part of our community offer, we've had things like investments in intermediate care and step up, step down provision. What we're trying to do is now take that a step forward, and you'll hear some labels and language around discharge to assess and home first. And the national best practice is basically saying that if you're 80 or over, if you spend 10 days in an acute or a community bed, you have the equivalent of 10 years of aging, and you don't get that condition back. So the drive really is to really avoid, build on what we've done, avoid an admission wherever possible, and support people to remain in the community. But if that's not possible, somebody does need an acute admission, and then to actually reduce that length of stay to be as short as possible. So we are doing lots of capacity and demand modelling across the whole system that starts to look at what's the pressure on the acute, what's the current community provision, and what would the community provision need to look like in terms of numbers of therapists, social workers, nurses, GP support, etc., etc., and also being in the sexy market in terms of how much domiciliary care, how much demand for mobile nights and so on, really would we need if we were going to really make a difference and change that model and approach. We're also trying to really look at changing our whole discharge process as well, so that we know that at the moment, if you're in an acute bed at Arrow Park, 50% of those patients have been there for more than 7 days, and we call that a stranded patient metric. So we're trying to really reduce those people and that want to stay down to 2 or 3 days at most, wherever we can. So there's some really positive work going on across the whole system, and everybody's working very hard really to look at how we can best deploy resources and maximise where we put that rural pound. We have had unprecedented pressure over winter, which I know we have shared with some of you previously. A&E has had huge increases in attendance, and there have been huge increases in acute admissions. That pressure has equally been felt in the community, and it's not just a rural issue, it has been felt regionally and nationally, as you'll see in the press. The Better Care Fund's original target was to avoid admissions of around 3.5% over the year. At month 10 in January, our position against that target had slipped, and we are currently at month 10 only achieving 2.7%, and that's because there has been a deterioration December, January time because of that unprecedented pressure. So it has reinforced that we do really need to scale up that community offer and make sure there's flow. The domiciliary care market has been fragile in recent months, which hasn't helped the flow, and will have contributed in part, but not in total, to some of the slippage against those that target. So not only are we looking at our health and social care resources in the models of care, we're also working with our independent sector providers to look at new models of care as well, and different approaches to domiciliary reenrolment provision. Partly because we know that even if there was all the money there, actually getting the people probably will be taking it over 12 months really to look at some redesign models, and we can certainly update and share back with this group the thinking around that. Very quickly then, the Better Care Fund continues to drive some of the work that we wanted to look at in terms of our emission avoidance. We continue to invest in that robust 7-day offer. We will be then looking at how we reprioritise on this modelling and demand and capacity work that we're doing. And we are looking in the next year to further invest in our home first model about supporting people in their own homes, in investing in that discharge to assess approach, and further triage, telehealth, where we know that will have a huge difference. So we will be coming back with recommendations about reprioritising some areas of funding to continue the work that we're doing. Final couple of comments around the work we wanted to do around quality and ensuring that it was best practice. The Integrated Quality Assurance team continue to work with our Integrated Contracts team. Andrew said that we're taking that form through that integrated commissioning approach, so there is absolutely room for improvement, and we're going to keep building on that. But they stay close to that range of provision, and as new models emerge and we look at successful approaches, we will need to change the approach we have for quality assurance and make sure that that's current and relevant, and put us in the highest learning from the safeguarding presentation. And finally, I think our immediate focus is to keep, as a whole system, driving that pace and change, and I'm really looking at how we spend a bit more focus and time thinking about our communication and really helping achieve that hearts and minds and behaviour shift across the whole system that we need, and that's a challenge for all of us and why it's really important we work collaboratively together.
Thank you, Jackie. I mean, this is very much an update on the first review we did last year, and I want to make that clear, so I want to start the review again. However, I would like to say we were aware that there's an awful lot of work going on and in other ways to bring services, get the right services in the right place for people. But the strain continues, and it's a little bit like pushing the water up there, isn't it? Just one point I would like to make. One of the things that we spent quite a lot of time on, and Ian Allen might want to raise this, because he's our money man really, was that we got the funding stream needed, the funding arrangements needed to be changed from payment by resource scheme. Now, I understand the local difficulties when you're talking about something like that, but I noticed that the allocation, the contract allocation, the contract has gone for 17-18, and we're still getting a payment by resource. Did any progress at all get made on that?
It did. So we, for 16-17 in the current biology year, we do have one contract with the hospital trust. I think the learning from that is that where we need to move to is contractual form needs to follow the models that we've put in place. So we've had a block contract for this year, but actually what I think we need to do is that urgent care transformation work and then identify which model of contracting needs to sit to support that. Because the contractual model in itself doesn't solve the problem. It's the transformation of the system that will hopefully solve the problem, and then we need to build contracts.
The round recommendation for emission prevention, you've got a figure there of achieving 4.2% reduction in emissions. So, is that what you're going for? Is it going to get better? What are the challenges?
So, as I was saying, when we did the report, the next month's report showed that change to 2.4%. So, our target nationally is 3.5% to achieve this year. We were at 4.2, but because of the winter pressure from December into January, February, it slipped to 2.7. We're working very hard to get that back up, but we will continue that 3.5% target for 17-18. Okay.
Yeah, thanks very much. Following on Wendy's point about admission prevention, one of the things that concerns me, and I see all the television and concern about people turning up at A&E and you really should go and see a pharmacist. I took ill on Christmas Day, and as the day went on, I got steadily worse. I didn't realise how bad it was. somewhat embarrassed when it got to about midnight. I thought, should I go to A&E? When I got there, they told me I was really in a bad case, so they put me in the acute medical unit, and I got superb service. But some of the publicity on saying, oh, don't go to A&E, can be counterproductive, where people who really need to attend can be put off. I mean, I thought I would drive there in my car, they'd spray my throat and send me home, but I spent 4 days in hospital. But I must say, the treatment I got was absolutely superb.
It's difficult to get the balance right between the communication and whether it should be purely focused at, you know, don't go to A&E, which absolutely shouldn't. I think what we need to do is promote some of those national messages around use of 111, and that's had its own issue, but actually 111 is that urgent. I think the number that you call, and that should direct you to the right place, so it's getting that message right.
Yeah,
but
I'm Treena.
Yeah, I was just sort of a good question, really. I mean, some of these recommendations sort of overlap as you look at it, because you're looking at new ways of working and new pathways. One, though, you specifically mentioned is this urgent care value stream analysis, and then you talk about this would lead on to a wider consultation with the public. What sort of timing are you thinking for the?
Okay, so the value stream analysis is now complete, and there were members of the public being involved throughout the value stream analysis from our patient groups. Where we're at now is we are actually developing the pre-engagement work for the prior to the consultation, and that's currently in development. Obviously, we've got PERDA coming up, so we won't be putting anything out to for public consultation until after. But the timescales are within this year, with a view to the public making an option for a transformed system by, I think we've set November in our timescales.
Treena.
Yeah, I was just
there
confirmation, you know, that we launched the board in admissions last year. We talked about a single front door process in A&E. And I can't wait to see that in the open. I know we talk about it in five, a single point of access aims, design goes and advise people. Is that still the single front door access? What's happened there at A&E? Do we still have it or not?
Okay, so there isn't a single front door at A&E. It was a trial that was evaluated and unfortunately wasn't as successful as we'd anticipated. However, what we have done is developed, you mentioned the single point of access, so the single point of access has been developed and is now, for local GPs is that point of contact to get advice around navigating the right point. What I would say is that there is a national push from NHS England that we will be adopting it for what's called streaming. So that is basically, it's a single front door by a different term actually. So it's having somebody, a senior nurse at the front door, having an initial conversation with the patient to identify where they need to go, where their care can be best served, whether that's at a pharmacy, whether that's back to their GP or whether that's in A&E. And that the timescales of that are, we are testing that out at the beginning of April. We will have a pilot in place over Greece, but then we have to roll that out. So within this year, we have to roll that out.
So it's not there, but you're looking at getting something in place?
Yes.
Through one nurse available there to do signposting?
One nurse 24 hours a day. Bear in mind that this is just about that initial signposting. There's a whole triage system that sits within A&E already, and that happens on an ongoing basis and within the walk-in centres. As soon as you walk in, you undergo that triage.
I just don't know why it's taken away. It looked at, the answer to their, avoiding admissions. It was the answer to it, really. And then to find out it's been removed is very disappointing.
It wasn't as successful as we anticipated in terms of deflecting people to other places.
go through the four constituency areas in Wirral, in terms of the 12 months check, Birkenhead, the take up was 60%, or the reviews were undertaken this time last year, and that's now risen in March to 89.8% of those 12 months reviews. In Worsley, in January, it was 70.27%, and in March it's now 73.03%. And there's further work going on in Worsley looking at venues and the times of work that can be offered by health visitors to meet need. In South Wirral, that's where the biggest increase has been seen, 77.55% in January, and a rise to a take of 19.74% in March. And in West Wirral, this is the area that sees a slight decrease from 17.83% in January to 68.89% in March. So overall, in February, the average outturn is 89%. So it is showing it's going in the right direction. And there's considerable work around that through the Community Trust and engagement with general practitioners and families and hospitals.
I think what we've done is that we have targeted Birkenhead because of the degradation. And obviously that, you know, the improvement there is showing. And I think there's a set next that we obviously want to see what we can do in policy. But I do think we do need to concentrate on West Wirral as well. Because obviously that's a one that dips around. And what we have to do is to understand our communities and how people live in those communities, we need to perhaps target in different ways. So it might be, I'm assuming, it might well be in West Wirral it's harder to engage because women are actually out of work, so how else can we engage with them? Do we have to try and engage with nannies or nurseries, look at the different ways to engage and at different times. So we need to reflect on how we, at different times, how we respond. Okay. But generally, it's a good picture, it's just that we know where we need to focus now.
In terms of the children achieving a good level of development.
70, the bottom indicator regarding self-harm. And also looking within the sponsor overview, it mentioned the 2016 Youth Parliament, of which the theme was mental health. Now at this conference there was a very brave trans teenager who spoke about self-harm and suicide rates within the LGBT community. What I'd be interested in seeing is if there's any possibility of getting a breakdown of the individuals admitted to hospital who are young within the LGBT community, as there is a massive debate